Hello, sports fans, sports collectors, and all hobbyists. Welcome to the Card King Sports and Variety Show. I'm your host, the Catman, Brian Cataquet, a.k.a. the Card King. We are live on ABC's KMET 1490AM.com, your number one spot right here for news and talk on the West Coast. You can also catch this show live on Alexa by saying, Alexa, play KMET Radio for your listening pleasure. On the telephone line, I welcome in a legendary New York Mets pitcher. We welcome in the great Jon Matlack. John Brian C., it's an honor to have you today.
Good morning, Brian. How are you?
Very well, John. John, your talent began very early. You had a remarkable high school career in which included 8 no-hitters, and I read something like a 22-1 record. Who do you credit your early success to, John?
I think it was just more or less the era of baseball in a small town in Pennsylvania that I grew up in. When I turned 8, the town started Little League, and I literally grew up with the league. We started with 4 teams, and it was emphasis on fun and fundamentals, and there was no pressure to win, and it was just a great environment to develop and flourish in, and I benefited from that.
And you were drafted 1 by the Mets in 67. Take us back to that time in which you first got that call or notification, and how was that feeling like?
It was a phenomenal feeling. I had no idea. Growing up all through childhood, all our friends were all going to become major league players. That's just what everybody was going to do, but we never had any idea that any of us ever would or how you would get there. We were actually at a graduation practice ceremony when baseball coach came chucking down onto the field and gave me the news that I had been picked by the Mets, first by the Mets and fourth in the country. It was very exciting.
And 1971, you recorded your first start with the Mets. Do you remember that first start? Was it nerve-wracking, or were you confident that you will handle the New York City buzz?
Well, it was actually on the road in Cincinnati, second game of a doubleheader, and the clubhouse man there tried to send me a bill for the carpet in the clubhouse. I was pacing so much that he said I wore his carpet out. but I did have a serious case of the nerves. I ended up pitching a pretty good ball game, and ironic as it was very close to the All-Star break, and I was behind 2-1, was pinch hit for, I think, in the seventh inning. Well, we scored a couple of runs, so I'm out of the game on the winning side of the record. And Seaver was brought in to relieve because it was so close to All-Star break. Unfortunately, a guy who hit a 2-run home run off of me also hit a home run off of Tommy and put the game away for Cincinnati, and we ended up losing. Instead of me having Seaver for a caddy, I ended up with a no decision.
Man, now in 1971 also, the Topps Company voted you to the rookie All-Star team, and you really lived up to all expectations you were given that year, which really means, John, you were instantly groomed to stardom the moment you became pro.
I don't know about that. I was a 22-year-old rookie just trying to get his feet wet in the major leagues and not embarrass himself. I was busy trying to keep my head down and get my job done.
You had a remarkable career, John. 72, voted unanimously Rookie of the Year. You led with 19 points. Number 2 was Dave Rader, and then 3 was John Milner, a former Met player, unanimously Rookie of the Year. How was it receiving that award in 72?
That was another one that I didn't really see coming. I had no idea there was such an award until somewhere in August. I guess it was in August. Sports writers started asking me about this Rookie of the Year thing, and I had to unfortunately say, what is that? I really didn't know, and they explained it to me, and it was a tremendous honor to win that, but I had no idea that there even was such an award present, and I was fortunate enough to win it. It was really pretty cool. It's hanging here on the wall. I can see it right now.
We're talking to the great Jon Matlack. John, 73, the playoff game versus the Reds. You performed brilliantly, shutting out the Reds in that playoff series. Do you remember vividly that series? How did you prepare going into the 73 playoff series?
Well, there was no real preparation other than the normal homework you would do getting ready for your next start, maybe with a little more emphasis to who might be in the lineup and who was hot at the time and that type of thing. But the thing that really stuck in my mind was the fact that, Tommy had pitched game one the day before, and we lost it 2-1. He pitched a phenomenal ball game. I charted the doggone thing, so I know where every pitch went and what it was. And two solo home runs, and we lose 2-1, and I'm leaving the ballpark going, what in the world have I got to do tomorrow if I'm going to beat these guys? So it was a little bit nerve-wracking and sort of anxious anticipation, wondering how everything was going to go.
Now, John, I have a cut I want to play. It's the 1973 NLCS Game 2 versus the Reds. This is the game that the great Bob Murphy stated on this broadcast that it was your most brilliant game in your career. Let's hear it.
Now the windup by John. Here's the pitch on the way. Swing and a miss, strike one. Minch has gone 0 for 3. Three times he's been thrown out on ground balls from the left side of the infield. Twice by Garrett, the last time by Buddy Harrelson. Curve inside and low, one ball, one strike. And that's returned to New York. Following the ball game, tomorrow, Jerry Kuz by Ross Grimsley at Shea Stadium. Just a little bit high, two balls and a strike. The 2-1 delivery. Foul tipped and held by Jerry Grody. The count is two balls and two strikes. Championship Series history, there has been one other two-hitter. That pitched by Ross Grimsley of the Reds, who faces New York tomorrow at Shea Stadium. Matlack with a count of two balls and two strikes. Into the windup. Here's the pitch. He struck him out. The ball game is over. The Mets defeat Cincinnati 5-0. The ninth strikeout of the game for Jon Matlack. He has just pitched a brilliant two-hit shutout. The Mets win it by a score of 5-0. In the ninth inning, no runs, no hits, no errors, and none left on. We'll be back with a happy recap in just a moment.
That was a great performance. You evened the series, John. You got the Mets back. You got the Mets back home. What do you remember most about that game?
Well, just that everything seemed to go the way it needed to go. If there was a pitch I needed to make, I was able to make it. If there was a circumstance where somebody needed to foul a ball off that might not have been in the right spot, they seemed to do that. The stars just lined up, and I was equal to the task. The stuff was there, and things worked out. It was a very good day for the Mets, very good day for me, and it's one that I remember fondly.
Amazing. 1973, you pitched in the World Series against the A's. If you can, take us back to the game in which you were on the mound for the first time in a real World Series game.
Well, actually, the playoffs probably were more nerve-wracking and tension-packed than the series, because the ultimate goal was to end up in the series. So once you were there, they can't take that away from you. Now it's compete at your best level while there. So the pressure wasn't as great, I don't believe, but it was a very exciting time. The A's were a tremendous ball club, and it was something that I look back on as probably some of the best competition that I ever had in my pro career.
Man, by 1974, I'm just going down chronologically, John, you know, a great career. By 74, you had the best ERA on the Mets staff, starting 34 games and recording 7 shutouts. So, I mean, I even read that Tug McGraw, it was an old-timer's day, he said that Matlack would be my man, followed by Kuzman, and then Steve Carlton, the Hall of Famer, in that order as being the most devastating left-handed pitcher Tug McGraw ever witnessed.
Well, dang, that's news to me. Thank you, Mr. Tug. That was a very nice thing to say. I never knew that he held me in such high esteem.
Yeah, I mean, he said he would have you one, Kuzman two, and then the Hall of Famer Steve Carlton. So, I mean, you definitely earned your respect amongst all your peers, no question about it. Now, John, you've been always generous with your signature, you know, like when people write your fan mail and you sign autographs through the mail. What do you think of the baseball card hobby? Do you have any opinions?
I do. It just blows my mind that it has grown or blossomed as it will into the industry that it has become today. If I had any inkling of what it would have become, you know, the cards that went in my bicycle spokes, I would have taken better care of. But it really is something to behold, and I am amazed to this day at the amount of mail that still comes my way with people interested in having baseball cards and pictures signed.
Yeah, and I also read that you kind of pioneered that. I mean, you had a bunch of pitches in your repertoire. You had an assortment of curveballs and changeups. And you also mastered or pioneered the cut fastball. How did you learn how to throw these pitches? What was your bread and butter pitch?
Well, when I got to the big leagues, I only had two pitches, which was just a fastball and a curveball. And I was pretty much told that you're going to have a tough time existing with just two pitches. And as we got into the competition, I fiddled with those pitches so that the fastball became three because I could keep it straight. I learned how to run it into a right-hander, and I also learned how to sink it. So I had three different looks with the fastball, and then I started to do similar things with the curveball in that there would be one that might be a power curve that would break shorter but later and sharper, and maybe a bigger, slower one thrown slightly differently with a little bit less pressure on the grip, so that I was able to change speeds and looks on the curveball as well, and that gave me a maybe six or seven pitches instead of just the two by varying speeds and that type of thing.
Well, now also by 1977, the Texas Rangers acquired you in a trade. I want to ask you, how was it adjusting to the Texas life coming from the East Coast? You played 7 years as a Met and, you know, 6 years as a Ranger. Was it more enjoyable for you personally with the teammates' lifestyle as a Met or as a Texas Ranger?
I think I was first and foremost a National Leaguer and probably will always hold the National League is probably just a little bit higher than the American League in terms of my favorite. I enjoyed both. They were different, but maybe because I was exposed to National League first, I felt like I have a little more kinship with it. Texas was a great place to play. I had to adapt to the weather. It was a lot hotter. The stadium was friendly, depending on what direction the wind was blowing in Texas. So the heat was probably the biggest thing. And the fans, maybe not as knowledgeable, not about the game, but about who everybody was. I couldn't go too many places in New York without being recognized. But in Texas, that was not the case. People were into the sport, but not so much into recognizing you away from the stadium.
Yeah, and that 1977 year, the Mets were one of the four teams involved in that very complex deals in history of baseball, that trading deal, which, you know, the Mets sent Milner to Pittsburgh, Montanez, you know, the Atlanta Braves sent Montanez to the Mets, Rangers sent Blylevin to the Pittsburgh Pirates, and then the Mets sent Jon Matlack, yourself, to the Texas Rangers. So it was really one of the most complex trades in baseball history, they say.
It was complex enough that I can't tell you how it all worked to this day. I know there were four teams and 11 players involved, and I ended up going to Texas. So that's about all I remember about that.
Now, I read that the Mets were going, you know, they plan to honor you as a New York Met Hall of Famer. That was scheduled for a May 17th. Is that correct?
Yes, sir, it is.
So did that get, obviously, did that get postponed, or did you? What's the news on that?
At this moment, they have tentatively rescheduled it for August 30 of this year, assuming that there is baseball and that it would be in Shea, I'm assuming, but I have gotten no more information on that. I guess until Major League Baseball and the players figure out how the safest way is to continue and if they're going to be able to continue, then maybe the other pieces will fall into place.
Well, you know, congratulations on that. It's very well deserved. I wanted to ask you, playing with Yogi Berra, can you give us any, how was it playing with Yogi Berra around 1973?
Yogi was great. Yogi was great as a coach, and he was really easy to play for as a manager. Just good people, all around good people. He said, pretty much, here's the bats and balls. Go win me a ball game. He wasn't into telling you so much how to do it and when to do what. Once in a while would put a play on or reposition a player, but generally just put the best nine out there for that day and said, go win me a ball game. Very easy to play for.
Yeah, and one of the fascinating things about the about, you know, just what comes to mind is your baseball card. You know, the Topps Company, they issued you with two rookie cards. In 1971, you have a rookie card issued by Topps, and also in 1972, you have a rookie card. So 2 years, really, you know, you have Topps issued you with a rookie card. Were you aware of that?
I really wasn't, and I'm not that versed in all the various cards and who made them and what the demarcations may or may not have been. I know that some of them that I receive in the mail have got a little rookie emblem stamped on them, and some of them do not, but it's the same picture, so I'm not real sure how or why any of that was done. That was obviously done by the card company, but that's news to me, two rookie cards. That's pretty cool.
Yes, 71-72. And growing up, John, who was your idol in baseball? You know, who did you admire growing up?
Sandy Koufax.
Really? Sandy Koufax, huh? And I'm sure you got a chance to meet Koufax, right?
I did. Actually, would have had a chance to watch him pitch in the World Series, but it was going to be the Game 5 in Baltimore in 66. But the Dodgers ended up winning in four, so there wasn't a Game 5 in Baltimore. Therefore, I miss seeing him pitch in person. But I did get to meet him later in life. I actually played golf with him a couple times. Very nice guy, and he's the reason that I wore number 32.
Wow. Now, so what have you been up to, you know, the last 5 to 10 years? What has the legendary Jon Matlack been up to these days?
Basically cooling his heels between the Adirondack Mountains and Florida, depending on the time of year. I've retired from baseball in 2012. After 2012, I'd spent a lot of time coaching from my playing days to that point in time. And since then, I've been doing nothing but just piddling around the house and whatever comes to mind. I have no demands on my time at this point, and I'm just enjoying life.
Yeah, can you see baseball returning? What are your thoughts on baseball coming back in 2020?
I really don't know what may happen or how it might be done. I certainly hope that they're able to figure out a way to safely bring the game back. But at this point, my crystal ball is very foggy on that subject. This is a crazy bug that's running around here right now, and we don't have a real good handle on it just yet.
Yeah, and you know, just for the fans listening, I don't know if you have a website or, you know, if someone wanted to purchase some of your items, are you involved in a website, or if, you know, fans interested in purchasing your merchandise, can they contact you? How does that work?
I don't have merchandise per se. I have and will sign most things that people send to me and have return postage included. But no, my son and my wife put together a fan page. I think it's called Jon Matlack Fans on Facebook. But I'm rarely there. I check it out once in a while. My son sort of looks after that for me. But I've never gotten into the merchandise side of things at all.
And do you ever get that itch, John, that itch that, you know, during your alone times getting back on the field, does that ever leave you, that impulse ever leave you?
I don't think it ever does. I don't know that it ever will. My impetus nowadays, if I were to go back, certainly not as a player, your mind might say you can, but your body says, oh, no, you can't at age 70. But the coaching aspect was a whole lot of fun for me, and one of the things that I really enjoyed about it was when you were dealing with somebody on whatever concept and you see the light go on in their eyes that they've captured that idea that you've been talking about or trying to teach them, and you know that no matter where they travel in this world through life, that a little piece of you is going to travel with them, and that's really a cool feeling.
Oh, no question about it. Just my final question. What do you think of the younger youth and all these kids playing little league ball? Do you still think that the game is very popular on the East Coast? Because I know that the West Coast and the warmer weather climates, the game is very popular. What do you think about the East Coast? You think the game is still popular amongst youths?
I think it's still popular. I think the game has changed so much and things have become so demanding time-wise, where they want you to play the sport year-round at a much earlier age than probably is a good idea in my mind anyway. My whole take on it is it ought to be fun when you're growing up and not any pressure to win. You ought to be allowed to develop and learn the game and have fun doing it so that when you get to maybe high school, when you're winning for a team, your school team or something like that, that pressure then is something that you can assimilate and have it work for you instead of being told as a 9-year-old, take these pitches because this guy can't throw strikes and that's how we're going to beat him. We're going to walk until we score enough runs. And that's not teaching kids the game. They ought to be allowed to learn the game and have fun doing it.
And how does a kid become a, you know, in your opinion, you're an expert pitcher. How does a kid become a dominating pitcher? Does he need a few pitches in his repertoire? Does he have to throw the high heater? What does a young kid need to be a dominant pitcher these days?
Well, if you don't have the luxury of throwing 104, which not too many guys do,
right.
To me, it's the ability to command your pitches. You need to know with a great percentage of accuracy where the ball is going when you turn it loose so that you can walk it around the strike zone, in and out of the strike zone at any given time based on information that the hitter supplies you each time he approaches a pitch. And you analyze that information and decide where to go with the next pitch. And the object in my mind is not to strike anybody out necessarily, but you're looking for friendly contact to let the other 8 players on your team play field a ground ball, field a fly ball, get an out as quickly as possible, move on to the next hitter.
I mean, that's some valid advice from the great Jon Matlack. Final words, John, anything you want to add? I appreciate your time today.
I am good. I've enjoyed speaking with you. It's always fun to talk shop. Happy to do it anytime.
Oh, I appreciate it. And, you know, stay safe during these chaotic times.
Certainly, and you too.
Thank you. That was the, everyone listening, that was the great Jon Matlack. And, I'm very happy to know that the New York Mets will be honoring Jon Matlack as a New York Met Hall of Famer. And as John mentioned, sometime in August, I know January 2020, it was announced by the New York Mets that they will be honoring Jon Matlack as a New York Met Hall of Famer. It was scheduled, the ceremony was scheduled for May 17th, but during these crazy times, it was definitely postponed. So I'm very happy for that. And, you know, in my opinion, I think Jon Matlack was the most dominating left-handed pitcher. This is for me, my opinion, the most dominating left-handed pitcher in Mets franchise history. And I'm so happy to have Jon Matlack on. And I wanted to, for everyone to know that starting June, July, my show will be airing 8 a.m. Pacific Coast time, 11 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. And also, again, Jon Matlack, for you fans listening to the program, his rookie card is 1971. Topps also issued a 1972 rookie card of Jon Matlack, which is kind of unusual for the Topps company to issue two rookie cards in different years of a player. But, you know, that's the way it is. 71 Topps Jon Matlack and 72 Topps Jon Matlack is considered his rookie card and one of the most dominating pitchers in New York Mets history.